Good evening, all the participants, and welcome to the fourth edition of the research discussion on graphs and groups. Today, the usual host is the speaker, so I have taken over charge for the conduct of this program. 21st April is a very significant day as far as Indian mathematicians are concerned. Today is the first death anniversary of Professor S.S. Srikande, who passed away exactly on this day last year. As you all know, Srikande, popularly known as one of the Euler spoilers, by disproving about 150-year-old conjecture of Leonhard Euler on mutually orthogonal Latin squares. So we pay tribute to that great Indian scholar. And now I hand over to invite Professor Geeta Venkatraman, Professor Ambedkar University, Delhi, to introduce the speaker, Dr. Aparna Lakshman. Geeta.
Welcome once again to all of you. And in India, it's a difficult period for us with the COVID wave in its real exponential growth. But we have the pleasure to hear Aparna Lakshmanan today on parameters of graphs defined on groups. Aparna is a young assistant professor at Cochin University of Science and Technology. She did her master's and her PhD at QSAT, and then did a stint of teaching at St. Xavier's College for Women. And she has several papers in graph theory and group theory in well-known journals, and has also many awards to her credit. I will only mention two. One is that she stood first in her master's in QSAT, and the other is that she had the Kerala Young Scientist Award for a project during her post-PhD period. And she's very active in her research area. And so let's hear from her today on parameters of graphs defined on groups.
Today is the first death anniversary of Srikande, who died at the age of 102 on 21st April 2020, and very well known as Euler spoiler. So I dedicate today's talk to him. Again, I don't belong to that expert panel whom we have invited for this research discussion, but I belong to the participants group. I'm also new to this area. I'm just presenting something which I have read from the paper shared by Professor Cameron, and some of my observations, and something which I found interesting. Okay, so let me move on to the presentation. We were already introduced to graphs defined on groups, but since the gap was a bit longer due to the election and due to the festivals, I'll just recall the definitions for those who are new to this group. We had already introduced four types of graphs in the first lecture itself: the commuting graph, the power graph, the enhanced power graph, and the generating graph. All these graphs have vertices of the vertices as elements of the group. The elements of group serve as vertices of the graph. In commuting graph, two vertices are made adjacent if they commute with each other. That is xy equal to yx. And the complement is also an interesting class of graphs called non-commuting graphs, where adjacency is made when elements do not commute with each other. Then comes power graph. In fact, power graphs are directed graphs in which there is a directed edge from x to y. If y can be written as a power of x, if y equal to x raised to m, there is a directed edge from x to y. The underlying simple graph without directions are also sometimes termed as power graphs and studied. Then comes enhanced power graphs. In enhanced power graphs, two vertices x and y are made adjacent if xy is cyclic. That is, both x and y can be expressed as a power of some other term, say z. Next one is generating graphs. In generating graphs, x is made adjacent to y if the group generated by x and y is precisely G itself. That is, xy serves as a generator of G. So these were the four types of graphs defined from groups, which we were discussing during the first two sessions.
I have one doubt, madam.
Yes.
So can you go to previous slide?
Yes.
So the third one, enhanced graph, suppose it's like inner graph generated by x plus xy, mean that is cyclic, mean the graph generated by x cyclic.
Generated by xy is cyclic. The subgroup H generated by X and Y is precisely the cyclic group generated by another number, say Z.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. So today we will be focusing on some of the graph parameters. A graph parameter is basically a function defined on the class of all graphs to the real numbers. In most of the practical cases, this codomain is restricted to either to natural numbers or maybe to whole numbers, not more than that. But there are graph parameters which are defined to say rationals, irrationals, even negative numbers and even complex numbers. There are such parameters, but the parameters which we are discussing today are all in fact defined to the set of all whole numbers, natural numbers together with another number zero. And this function need not be one-one and need not be on-two. We have examples for graph parameters which are neither one-one nor on-two, which are one-one, which are one-one but not on-two. All such sorts of examples are there in case of graph parameters. Here are some of the examples of well-known graph parameters. Chromatic number, which we will discuss in details today. Then radius, diameter, and connectivity. Regarding these parameters, we have talks coming up in the following weeks. Then comes independence number, which I would like to mention a few in today's talk. So these are some of the examples of graph parameters. Today I'll be focusing on four of this: chromatic number, independence number, domination number, and clique number. So I'm taking three of them: chromatic number, clique number, and independence number. I understand that there are a few people who are working in abstract algebra, that is groups, and those who are not that familiar with terminologies from graphs, which I got from feedback from the participants. So I will just give the definition of these parameters. First one is chromatic number, which is the minimum number of colors required to properly color the vertices of a graph. A proper coloring means no two adjacent vertices receives the same color. Such colorings are called proper coloring, and the minimum number of colors required to do such a coloring is called the chromatic number. Usually we denote it by the Greek letter chi. And then comes clique number. Clique number is the maximum order of a complete subgraph. A subgraph is said to be complete if every pair of vertices are adjacent to each other. Usually a maximal complete subgraph is termed as cliques, but there are some research papers and even textbooks where complete subgraphs are called cliques. That maximality condition is not there. Even otherwise, every complete subgraph is termed as clique, but popularly maximal complete subgraphs are known as cliques. And the maximum order of a complete subgraph of a given graph is the clique number denoted by omega of G. Then comes independence number. It is just opposite to that of clique number. Here we are looking for independences. A subset of a vertex set is said to be independent if no two vertices are adjacent to each other. Take a maximum possible such set, and the cardinality of a maximum independent set is called independence number. As it is in some sense complementing the clique number, in reference, in literature, you can see that independence number are sometimes called as co-clique number. From the definition itself, the relation between clique number and independence number is evident. The clique number of a graph G is same as the independence number of its complement and vice versa. So that is the relation between clique and independence. And chromatic number is also closely related to these two parameters. If you have a clique of size k, then we can be sure that we require at least k colors to properly color the graph. You have a click of size k. So every pair of vertices are adjacent to each other, and we need one color to each of these k vertices. So at least k colors are required to color the graph. So chromatic number is always greater than or equal to click number. And the graphs which attain equality, not only for G, but for all its induced subgraphs also, are termed as perfect graphs. And we have discussed something about perfect graphs during the second lecture, I believe. So that is the relation between chromatic number and click number. Again, there is a relation between independence number and chromatic number also. So you take a proper coloring. Each color class gives you an independent set. So that gives you a relation between the independence number and the chromatic number. So these regarding these three parameters and graphs defined on groups, some papers are written. The first paper in which I would like to concentrate is this one, A Problem of Paul Ehrlich on Groups by Newman in 1975. In fact, in the pioneer paper, in the first paper, Ehrlich was focusing on non-commuting graphs. There he defined, in fact, we know that non-commuting graphs are complements of our commuting graph, but in that paper, he had defined it in a different language. Again, the vertices are elements of group G, and G and H are adjacent if G inverse, H inverse, GH is not equal to 1, where 1 is the unit element, is the multiplicative identity. In this way, he had defined that adjacency, but we can see that this is nothing but G and H do not commute with each other. So the graph which he was considering, he was defining from the group, was the non-commuting graph. The question posed by Ehrlich was that let G be such that gamma, here gamma denotes the non-commuting graph generated from G, gamma contains no infinite complete subgraph. Is there a finite bound on the cardinality of complete subgraphs of G, of gamma? So the assumption is gamma do not contain infinite complete subgraphs. But can we say that there is a finite bound on the cardinality of complete subgraphs of gamma? That was the question raised by Ehrlich. Affirmatively, that question was answered by Newman. For that, we need three kinds of groups. The first one is PE groups. In fact, this is Paul Ehrlich group as named by Newman. The property which was desired by Paul Ehrlich and that class, that was named as PE groups. Groups whose graphs do not contain infinite complete subgraphs. Such groups were named as PE groups. We need another type of groups called FIZ groups. These are groups whose center has finite index. You take the center, you find the index. If that is finite, then that belongs to FIZ group. Then comes FC groups. FC groups are groups in which the classes of conjugate elements are finite. Please note, classes of conjugate elements, that becomes finite. Then such groups are called FC groups. From the definition itself, it immediately follows that FIZ groups, the collection of all FIZ groups, which we denote by FIZ within square brackets, that sits inside the FC groups. What about other connections? In fact, all PE groups are FC groups. That is what he had proved in that paper. The proof is using the negation argument. Assume that G is not an FC group. So G does not belong to that category of being FC groups. And we prove that it is not a PE group either. So our assumption is G is not an FC group. So there exists an element G which have an infinite conjugate class, because G do not belong to FC. You take that G and define T as the collection of elements that produce distinct conjugates of G. Definitely, T is an infinite set. And the two elements, S and T, belongs to T if their conjugates are different. That is, S inverse GS is not equal to T inverse GT, then S and T belongs to T. That is how we define the set T. Now restrict gamma to T. Gamma is defined for the group G. Now T is a subcollection of elements of G. So we can restrict the gamma to the set T and apply Ramsey's theorem there. According to Ramsey's theorem, gamma of T either contains an infinite complete subgraph or an infinite independent set. One of these must hold. If it contains an infinite complete subgraph, then it is not a PE group. According to the definition of PE group, that does not belong to PE group. So in that case, we are done. So consider the case where there is an infinite independent set. And let U be an infinite independent subset of T. And consider the left coset GU. You can prove that this GU forms an infinite complete subgraph. You can take any two elements, say GU and GV, and compute GU inverse, GV inverse, GU, GV, and see that they do not commute with each other. So that forms a complete subgraph in the non-commuting group. So in that case also, we are able to produce a infinite class of infinite class of clique. So this does not belong to PE group. So does not belongs to FC implies does not belongs to PE. That is what first they have proved. All PE groups are FC groups. To move ahead, we need another definition of that of centralizer. The centralizer of an element, say G, denoted by CG of G, is the elements which commutes with G. And the centralizer of a set, yes, is the collection of all elements which commutes with every element of yes. Index of the centralizer, denoted by G colon CG of G, is the cardinality of the class of conjugates of G. It is equal to, it's not defined as, but it can be seen that it is equal to the cardinality of the class of conjugates of G. So if G belongs to FC, then this index is finite for all G belongs to G. If this index is finite, then for every finite set, yes, this index G, C, G, S is finite. This part we need, okay. Now what will be the relation between FC and FIZ groups? It was proved that if G belongs to FC and G has an abelian subgroup A of finite index, then G belongs to FIZ. It is not true that every FC belongs to FIZ, but if it has an abelian subgroup A of finite index, then it belongs to, then the group belongs to FIZ. Or equivalently, we can say that if G belongs to FC minus FIZ, that it's an FC graph but not an FIZ graph, and it has a subgroup A of finite index, then that subgroup will not be abelian. Okay, so that's an equivalent formation of the same. Now the proof moves like this. Take a graph G from FC minus FIZ, then we prove that G is not a Paul Erdős group. So that first they have proved this result. Let G be any graph which is FC but not FIZ, and G has two infinite sequences of n elements, say A1, A2, etc., AN, B1, B2, etc., BN, with the property that AIs do not commute with each other, AIs commute with BJ, and AI and BJ for I not equal to J. For I equal to J, AI and BI do not commute, and BI and BJ commute with each other for every I. If that is the case, then we can always append one element to both these sequences. Say I can find an AN plus 1 and BN plus 1, such that this property is preserved. That is, AIs do not commute, AIs commute with BJs, AI do not commute with BI, and BI commute with BI. So we can always append that sequence. So if we are starting with a non-abelian group, then definitely I can have a sequence with one term, say A1 and B1. I can always find A1 and B1 such that these properties are satisfied. Once this property is satisfied by n elements, the lemma assures that this can be extended to n plus 1 elements. So using that, you can start with a pair A1, B1, which always exists if the starting graph is non-abelian. So start from that. And you can always generate an infinite sequence, where that first infinite sequence, you can see that do not commute with each other. So that forms an infinite clique in the corresponding graph generated from this group, which means this is not an element of P. This does not belong to Paul Erdős class of groups. So what we have proved is that if it belongs to FC minus FYZ, then it is not P. From that, we can move to the fact that P is equal to FZ. We have proved that P's are FC. And if G belongs to FC minus FYZ, then G is not P, which implies P sits inside FYZ. For the converse part, if G belongs to FYZ, then the index is finite, say equal to some n, so that if we take any n plus 1 elements, that must contain at least two elements which are congruent modulo to the sender Z of G, and which in turn implies that G belongs to P. So that means FYZ sits inside PE, and hence these two classes are equal. This is how the problem posed by Erdős was settled in that paper. Now, some extensions of this version, extensions of the problem posed by Paul Erdős was dealt in another paper which was published in 1981. In that extension, the problem similar to that, the Erdős post was settled for some other kind. Here the operator which we considered was non-commuting, but we were interested to make adjacency between non-commuting elements. That property can be changed to generate different graphs. The questions which were considered in that paper are being finite, soluble, finitely generated, polycyclic, super soluble, and coherent. For these six variations, the same problem are considered in that extended paper. Now let us move on to independence number of commuting graphs. So let G be an infinite group, then the following statements are equivalent. That is, COMG has no infinite co-clique. There is a finite upper bound on the size of co-cliques in COMG. And Z of G has finite index in G. It has been proved that these three statements are equivalent. It is not that this result is proved directly. The proof comes from this paper, coloring the power graph of a semigroup. Their approach is a bit different. The language used is a bit different. But we can, from that, we can conclude that has no infinite co-clique. So that is not a direct proof, but an indirect one, which can be restated like this. Then comes the independence number of power graph. A similar statement holds here also. Here we have three equivalent statements, but in the case of power graph, that is not true. But we have an almost similar result. Power graph of G has no infinite co-cliques. Then Z of G has finite index. The center of G has finite index in G, which was a third equivalent condition, and is a direct sum of finitely many P torsion subgroups of finite rank for premise P. So that is what holds for independence number of power graph, the proof of which you can find in the paper non-cyclic graph of a group. And then comes the enhanced power graph. A statement which is equivalent to that of independence number holds here. Independence number in commuting graph holds here for enhanced power graphs. You take any infinite group G, then the statements are equivalent. Enhanced power graph of G has no infinite co-clique. There is a finite upper bound on the size of co-cliques in enhanced power graph of G, and Z e power G has finite index in G. Note that in the case of commuting graph, what we were considering was sender. Sender of G has finite index G. Index in G, here it is different. Here we are taking Z e power G, where Z e power denotes the cyclicizer of G. Center is the collection of all terms which commutes with all other terms. Here that commuting is replaced with cyclicizer. So that's the case, and the proof you can find in this paper. Power graph of finite abelian groups due to Professor Tamil Selvan. I think I just jumped. In this paper, there are a few more results regarding the independence number of power graph of G. Until now, what we have discussed is whether this independence number is infinite or not, like the cases were discussed in all these papers. But here, you have some results based on specific values of independence number of power graph. So if G is a group whose order is P1 raised to alpha 1, P2 raised to alpha 2, etc., Pn raised to alpha n, where P1, P2, etc., Pn are distinct primes, then the independence number of the power graph of G is at least n, where n is the number of distinct primes. So you can be sure that you can find an independent set of cardinality at least n. And if the order is precisely P raised to n for some prime P and some positive integer n, then the independence number of the power graph is P raised to n minus 1 by P minus 1. In fact, in the case, the power graph, the structure of the power graph is specifically proved to be K1 join a particular structure. And for that structure, the independence number is known. So we can be sure that the independence number of power graph is P raised to n minus 1 by P minus 1. Then independence number of the power graph is 2 if and only if G is a cyclic group of order P raised to n q, where P and q are distinct primes and n is a positive integer. If G is a cyclic group of order P raised to n q, it is somewhat easy to prove that the independence number of the power graph is 2, but the converse part requires some work, but of course can be proved. Now, moving on to the last parameter, domination number of a graph. A set S subset of V is called a dominating set if every vertex U in V is either in S or is adjacent to a vertex in S. That is, the closed neighborhood of the set S is the full vertex set V. And a dominating set is said to be minimal dominating if no proper subset is dominating. And the domination number is the minimum cardinality of a dominating set. Sometimes I have seen that among research scholars who are starting up, there is a confusion between minimal and minimum. To prove that the domination number of a graph is equal to something, it is not enough that if you find a dominating set of minimal dominating set of that cardinality, you need to prove that there do not exist any other dominating set of lesser cardinality. As in this example, you can see that in all these three cases, the red vertices gives you a minimal dominating set. Here you have three vertices in the minimal dominating set, but it is not minimal. The domination number is 2. So it is not enough if you prove that there exists a minimal dominating set of such and such cardinality to prove that the domination number is equal to the cardinality of that particular set. So that is domination number of a graph. Domination number is a well-studied parameter, and many variations of domination number are also available in literature, say like total domination number, independence domination number are all celebrated and well-studied parameters with plenty of applications. But regarding graphs generated from groups and their domination number, I could find only two papers. In fact, I could find only two papers. Maybe there are others which I missed, but anyway, not more than a handful of papers in this area. One paper is domination number of the non-commuting graph of finite groups. In that paper, what they have proved is that let G be a non-commuting graph of order n, then the domination number of the non-commuting graph of G is strictly less than n minus t by 2, where t is the cardinality of center of G. Here, when defining non-commuting graphs, you can see that the identity element, and every vertex in the center commutes with all other elements of the group. So if we are considering non-commuting graph, these elements gives vertices which are isolated in the graph and are not interesting. Even when studying independence number or domination number or click size, these isolated vertices are not interesting. So in this paper, they are excluding that. While defining non-commuting graph as well as commuting graph, they are excluding all those vertices from the center. They are considering only vertices of only elements of G which are outside the center as vertices of the graph G. So when the elements from the center are avoided, the order of the graph becomes n minus t, and we know that n by 2, where n is the order of the graph, is an upper bound for domination number provided there are no isolated vertices. So from that itself, it is trivial that the domination number of non-commuting graph of order n is less than or equal to n minus t by 2. But what they have proved that it is strictly less than. That is, it can never be equal to n minus t by 2. That is what requires some proof. The less than or equal to path is trivial, but to prove that it is not equal to n minus 2 by t, again, that requires some work, but can be done. And this is for non-commuting graph of order n. When coming to commuting graph, if it is of odd order, then the same inequality holds, that it is strictly less than n minus t by 2. But if the order is not odd, if the order is even, there are examples for which the equality, that is equal to n minus t by 2, was attained.
Aparna?
Yes.
By commuting graph, the group they may be
Sorry, ma'am.
Yeah, they're using the non-abelian and abelian, right?
Yes, exactly. Non-abelian and abelian.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you. Okay. There is another result connecting the domination number of commuting graph of G and its complement. Complement means it is the non-commuting graph. So they are taking the domination number of commuting graph plus the domination number of non-commuting graph, which are, these graphs are complements to each other. So such studies are there in the area of domination theory. Maybe that is why they were interested in this. And the following results are obtained. The first one is again almost trivial. Gamma of gamma g plus gamma of gamma g complement is less than n minus t plus 1. Less than or equal to is trivially true, and strict less than requires some proof. Then for symmetric group S3, Q3 and D10, they have obtained the exact value of gamma domination number of gamma g plus domination number of gamma of g complement, that is commuting graph and non-commuting graph. They have domination numbers, and then taking their sum, they have computed the exact value for these three cases. Apart from that, there is only one more paper which was published in 2017 on the domination number, independent number, and the regularity of relative co-prime graph of a group. Here the graph defined from group was different. This type of group, this type of graph generated from group, we have not discussed. Their definition is like, again, the vertices are elements of group G, and two vertices are made adjacent if the order of the elements are relatively prime to each other. Then these elements are made adjacent to each other. That is the definition of co-prime graph. And the domination number of and independence number of co-prime graphs are discussed in this paper. All these papers are available for free download. Again, one of the most interesting class of graphs generated from groups is Cayley graphs. The literature is very vast. And we have read in that survey article by Professor Cameron, in the first section itself, we had mentioned that this is a major class, but we are excluding that from the survey due to the vastness of literature available in that area. Again, for Cayley graphs, the domination parameter is well studied. And you can find a survey paper due to Professor Tamilselvam on domination parameters on Cayley graphs. Now, with this question, I would like to conclude. What is the role of graph parameters in groups? If you take a particular graph parameter, what is the relation between that given parameter and a group property? Is there any particular connection? If there is no connection, then sometimes there may not be any meaning in evaluating that particular parameter for that graph. If there is some connection, if finding this parameter in the respective graph helps us to solve something or helps us to find something about the corresponding group, then only that becomes interesting. So my question is to the experts, not to me, don't ask back the question to me. My question to the experts who are present in this group is whether any graph parameters are found to be interesting in the study of corresponding groups. If such parameters are there, if the young researchers in this group can identify some graph parameters which are interesting in this sense, I'll consider this session as fruitful. So with that, I am concluding. Thank you.
Peter, any?
Yes. I think I have quite a few things to say. That was a nice talk. And gave me a few things to think about. So particularly the commuting graph and the generating graph, there are applications of graph parameters. So for example, the commuting graph goes right back to 1955 to a paper of Brouwer and Fowler. And this was the first paper in the long road that took us to the classification of finite simple groups. So they proved in that paper that if you have a simple group and you specify the centralizer of some element of order 2, then there are only finitely many possibilities for the simple group. And they did that by looking at the diameter of the commuting graph. So the diameter was the important parameter for them. So there are certainly applications. I will try and make a little list and send to you of other places where there are applications. But the original application of the commuting graph, I think, is a good example.
Thank you for that.
Can you please take the fifth slide or something where you started your talk?
Yeah, sure. This one?
Yeah, how difficult or how... Of course, it's significant, but how difficult is the Ramsey theorem for infinite existence of infinite complete subgraph or infinite independent set? Even as I understand, the finite version is very difficult, isn't it, Peter?
It's difficult to find the exact numbers.
Yes,
just get the bounds is not so bad. And in fact, the infinite case is probably easier than the finite case. I can give you a proof in a page of the infinite Ramsey theorem for graphs. It's not so hard.
I see.
But it's very nice to see it being used here, because of course Ramsey's theorem was the one of the big things that Paul Erdős worked on. And here's Ramsey's theorem together with some group theory being used to answer one of his questions. So it happened, in fact, that I was reading this proof just this morning because I wanted to remind myself how the proof went. It's a very nice proof, I think, and I'm very grateful to Aparna for the presentation. I really enjoyed that. So if you start talking about infinite cardinal numbers, then Ramsey's theorem becomes very, very difficult. But if you just say there is an infinite clique or an infinite independent set, that's not so hard.
So shall I conclude? And next week we have Saul Friedman from...
there's someone who raised his hand.
Pardon?
One of the participants has raised his hand.
Oh, I see.
Ali Reza Abdullah.
Hi.
He's going to be a speaker for June.
You have a question?
Oh, hi.
No, I would like to add a comment that maybe replacing the abelian class Bernhard Neumann result is unknown. For example, abelian with nilpotent of class 2. Of course, we know that with some additional condition, for example, finitely generated and solvable condition, we can arrive to the same similar result to the similar result to the Bernhard Neumann. But it is interesting to know if there is a similar result for as the Bernhard Neumann find for the in response to the Erdős question about the, for example, nilpotent groups of class 2, at most 2. If you, it is interesting to think about these questions because it's really in the spirit of the nature of the question of Paul Erdős, for example.
Yes.
As, I have some, even for the torsion-free case, assume that G is torsion-free, and every click of the nilpotent of glass at most 2 is finite. It is very difficult to find a result that is, one can find the upper bound on the click numbers of the graph. So I suggest you to think about it. Even for example, you may replace nilpotent of class at most 2 by something like that, abelian bicyclic and nilpotent of class 2 even. Even if this is very difficult. Replacing abelian by a very near class to the abelian groups is interesting to find. Of course, we know with additional condition. For example, if you want add even, I think, low carry-graded conditions on the group, you can find a similar result to Erdős, meaning that upper bound on the click numbers. Anyway, it's a comment to, if you like to continue these graphs, I think that's maybe the same question of Erdős for the other class. Of course, this is you have the speaker has mentioned the paper of John the Weigold and the Lennox. It's very interesting, but always they study groups with the conditions such that like solvability, something like that. Anyway.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the suggestion.
Any other? So let us thank the speaker and hope to see you next Wednesday for the talk by Saul Friedman. And the month of May, we have talks for all the 4 Wednesdays.
Please note the change in time for next Wednesday. Next Wednesday, it is 4:30,
yeah,
not 5:30. Definitely, I will send the remainder mail on coming Monday. See you all then.
Okay, bye.